Hey, so Sean, did my camera come on in time? I guess we'll find out when I watch the beginning of this video. What are you guys doing? I was told about this person. He's a crazy person. I didn't want to go too deep in the bottom of the barrel looking for his videos, but I found this one. That was deep enough. Trust me. He's going to talk about safety tools. Here we go.
Safety tools are the methods we use to make our players feel comfortable during a game. They're essential to employ in some form because we don't want our players to feel uncomfortable. That's not...
Why do you have players that might feel uncomfortable at your table? I don't understand. It's a game, right? You're just having fun, right?
Fun for anybody. If you disagree, I don't know what to tell you. I don't want the people at my tables to not have fun.
Okay, what does that mean? I don't even know what that means. If your characters are not having fun, that means they're uncomfortable? What if they're not having fun because everyone's playing wrong, bad fun? Does that make a player uncomfortable? Or they just want to leave? I think this guy needs to check himself. Uncomfortable and boredom are maybe two separate things.
Primary use of safety tools is usually to make sure that certain content does not appear during a D&D game, at least without warning. For example,
a D&D game. A D&D game. A game for the 8th graders. A game for fucking 8th graders. Okay, what could go wrong? Can they water down D&D any further? Dude, this guy's mentally ill, so he should know what I'm talking about here. They have trans... How should I say this? Drag queens in preschools prancing around in front of kids. Now, why? Why is that a thing? Did the preschoolers get to do, do they have any safety tools before these drag queens come into their class? Are safety tools even mentioned for these preschoolers? Here's a grown-ass man with rosacea, probably lupus for all I know, and he's concerned that we need safety tools for adults in a fucking D&D game. A fucking D&D game. Oh, by the way, I heard that Walmart is pulling out of Portland. So we are seeing the the beginning of the end. It's the beginning. Well, last year we saw the beginning of the end of Portland. Now we're seeing the beginning of the end of Portland. When Walmart pulls out of Portland, where are those people going to steal from? What store is left to steal from in that town?
Example, let's say that one player has an aversion to eye stuff. Anything that happens around eyes, they don't want to think about. They don't want to have it described at the table. You as the dungeon master need to know that, because if you're describing how the player takes...
What about skull? What about like forehead stuff? Do I need to do a... a Google search of Phantasm when that steel ball with the drill and the knife go inside that guy's skull, goes in his forehead, and drills into his brain? What about that? Are people okay with that? It's just the eyes. They don't want anything poking their eyes. They don't want blood coming out of their eyes. You know, yet another Stephen King storytelling book about people with blood coming out of their eyes. Seems like a normal, common occurrence. I don't know anyone who has a fear of their eyeballs being, having things. I'm not touching you, you know. A couple days ago, I heard about this guy. He got the Medal of Honor, something, something, citation or award or whatever it's called. One of his eyes was hanging out of his eye socket, and he was shooting. He was shooting bad guys. This is during World War II. And he casually put his eyeball back into his socket once he was done killing all the bad guys. What's this this mealy mouth asshole? What is he doing? Why is he playing D&D if it's harmful? What is he doing exactly? If you can't play D&D with your friends without having safety tools, what game can you play? You can't do Monopoly then. No way. They got jail. They got jail in that game. Don't drop the soap when you're in jail in that game.
Takes down the Beholder or the Cyclops. You want to make sure that you do so in a way that does not make the player who does not like eye stuff to feel uncomfortable. And that example...
Okay, so the trolls from Skyrim are out. They got, what, 6 set of eyes or something like that? The spiders, for sure. I think they have, what, 1, 2... I want to say they have 7 eyeballs.
Example is not even that far outside the realm of possibility.
And that's not even an eye being harmed. That's just you looking into the eye. The eye of the fucking beholder.
For standard D&D. There's a pretty iconic hero in this game whose catchphrase is, "Go for the eyes." For many of us, we would not think of...
What about Medusa? You're using your eye to look at the Medusa. That's kind of like... That's a challenge. That's a hardship. Technically, your eye is turning into stone before your very brain, which turns into stone next. But technically, it's not like you're being poked in the eye. Eye stuff. What about jars of eyeballs? What about Blade Runner? You're never going to play Blade Runner. He designed your eye.
Think of that as a pressure point for a player. But for some people it is. Safety tools can cover lots of it.
What about hand stuff? Finger stuff? You know, finger stuff? I always like the idea of a dog running off with someone's hand. You know, like this much of their arm gets cut off, and the dog takes it, runs off with it, gnawing on it. Later on, you see that dog's dead. It's been strangled, and there's no hand. The hand has walked away. I like that. Now, do people have hand issues, finger issues, eye stuff, hand stuff? What about people that are obsessed with the feet? I stubbed my toe. Oh my, that's the worst. Oh, safety tool. Card, X card. Oh man, that is the worst, getting your toe stubbed. How about paper cut? Oh, those are the worst kind of cuts. You don't even know you've been cut. Till like later on in the day, you're like, oh, what the fuck happened to my, And you're like, oh, that damn piece of paper from the office. Damn you. Some people don't like paper cuts. We're talking about grown-ass people playing fucking D&D, right? Remember that movie, that horrific movie based on Isaac Asimov's Nightfall? And there's that one scene where the lady has her eyes poked. Her eyes are picked out by a crow. Because she's obsessed with the, she's losing sanity points because Nightfall is going to happen. It's a world with near 3 suns. And there's going to be an episode where all 3 suns are on the other side of the planet. And so the planet's going to see nighttime for the first time ever. Everyone's going insane. They're going to go crazy. They do weird things. They can't handle just a fucking 5 or 6 minutes without any daylight.
Areas like behavior at the table, descriptions of scenes or imagery, language, content, all sorts of things. But you might think,
what kind of language is in D&D? Brussels? I remember seeing Brussels in one of the D&D books. It was okay. It was like, hey. She's not as pretty looking as the hot chick from Conan who got kicked in the fire. Is there like fireplace issues with people? Have they started banning fireplaces and taverns because the one player is not... You got a pyromaniac at your game table who is trying not to focus too much on fire. It's not healthy. When they see fire, it triggers them. Like, what do you do? It's like it's a Stone Age world. You're going to have campfires. Candle-lit things. Kitchen ovens. Woks. Stir-fry. You know, that kind of nonsense.
I don't need to use those. I'm just running a fun adventure game. We're not going to cover any serious subjects. But safety...
I mean, in the old days, you had the people that didn't like spiders. Okay. Oh, I don't like spiders. Well, kill it. Kill the fucking spider. Get over your goddamn fear. I don't like bears. Well, kill the fucking bear. You're a hero. You're a fucking hero. You have weapons. Kill the bear. Kill the bear. Put on its fur. You have a new fur coat. Put your head inside the bear's furry skull as a helmet. Now you got a cool-ass helmet. Scare the shit out of people. Roaming around in their village with this bear hanging off your back. Its teeth are like this in front of your eyes. Arrgh. But no, players are pussies in these D&D games.
Safety tools also make sure that all players are on the same page. For example, if one player wants to play a character...
I'm not even listening to this guy. What has he said so far? We're in a minute and a half, almost 2 minutes in. I haven't been listening to anything he said.
With the backstory of being a slave, because they think that's a cool backstory.
Oh yeah, when Mongoose Traveler had a book, it came out, Scoundrels, I think it was. There was a picture of this, basically a slaver. And he's got these hot chicks on leashes, and they're his slave girls. Oh, there was panic in the streets over on Mongoose Publishing, the forum. How dare you? How dare you, sir? And we didn't know. We didn't know at the time what was happening. You know, this is like 2014, 2015. We didn't know. No, I take that back. It was 2012, 2013. We didn't know what was going on. The term woke wasn't a thing yet. But there was something called social justice warrior. That was a catchphrase. We knew it was a cancer that was spreading, but we didn't know how it spreads at the time. It took off. Twitter spread that cancer light speed. Twitter was helping it spread. That's another thing. Thanks to Elon Musk, Twitter is now kind of a firewall. When things are posted on Twitter, I mean, they don't get blocked or deleted or anything. They just, anyone who says something against that, their posts don't get deleted or canceled. That's the real trick. You get to see the other side being talked about on Twitter for a change. For like the first time since, what, 2008? 2008, what was that? That was the first term of Obama. Obama did so much harm to the planet for 8 fucking years. And now we got Biden, who's Obama 2.0.
Story. It makes them feel like Spartacus. It's worth knowing if somebody else at the table feels like that's actually not fun escapism, that if they're going to have slavery in the game, it should actually be...
What's the context of your slavery? Okay, Fallout 3 has slavery, you know? And a cool thing with Fallout 3 is that there's... usually 3 outcomes with their quests. There's, you can be the good guy, you can be the bad guy, you can be the gray matter guy, you can be the guy who plays it neutral. So there's 3 outcomes in a lot of the Fallout 3 quests, which I think is cool. Depending on how you're role-playing your character. So the context is the same, but you can have three different outcomes for the slavers and the slaves. You could become a slaver if you want, or you could free the slaves, or you could just do nothing. You know, you just, not my problem. But I'm curious what his context of slaves are. I mean, obviously you don't want kids being slaves. And I don't know, it's all about context. You're gonna have fucking context for your slaves. That's what you're gonna have. The player characters can be fucking heroes and put an end to it. It's like, why bring it up? Why bring the slaves up in your game? Why would you do that? If there's not anything the players can do about it, why even mention it? It's like, here's some Rocky Road ice cream. I'm bringing this up just because you guys can't have any.
Handled in some sort of meaningful way, and if it's not going to be, maybe it shouldn't appear at all. Like, maybe slavery isn't just fun window dressing for your adventurer. Maybe it's an actual serious subject, and...
Fun window dressing? I'm trying to think when slaves were fun window dressing. Fun? Did he say fun window dressing or just window dressing? I mean, Democrats get all hoity-toity about slavery. They think it's still going on. They don't know their history. They have no clue what slavery even was. And they think America is fucking guilty of all of it that ever happened in the history of the world. They think America's been around forever since the beginning of Adam and Eve. There's slavery going on still in countries. Still, to this day. And these Democrats never bring it up. They never fucking bring it up. These cowards. They only talk about make-believe slavery that they heard about, that America did, all these white people did. They know nothing about the Civil War, what it was even about. They make up shit about it, you know, oh, the real reason, you know. You're talking to a Democrat when Democrats were the slave owners. Today, Democrats are still slave owners. They fucking a whole species of people, 93% of them, have the slave mentality still. The 7% of them are functional Americans, doing jobs, having kids, families, upstanding citizens. The rest of them, slave mentality. They're all, every fucking one of them is a Democrat. So you got these white crazy savior types on the Democrat side saying, oh, we got to do something about it. We have to do reparations again. Oh my God, let's take all the white people's money and give it to all the blacks. Like, no one alive had slaves. No one alive is a slave, and they're doing this reparations crap. You know, San Francisco's starting to collect money from people to just redistribution of wealth. Anyway, I don't want to talk about this nonsense. This is about safety tools, not about this guy's mental illness that spreads throughout the D&D hobby. Never, I've said this for years, don't invite fucking Democrats to your D&D table. Problem solved. Ay, ay, ay.
Shouldn't be taken so lightly. Now, one of the misconceptions about safety tools from people who don't feel like using them is usually that they get in the way, that they slow down
your... Here's a safety tool. What if someone with a gun comes into your house and shoots you? Are you armed? Do you have a gun? Can you defend yourself at all? This is like, what has he got, like white privilege or something? What is this about him? Does he have real world safety tools? He's just only concerned about safety tools in D&D? How does he function? How does he have, does he have coping skills when he steps outside?
Your game. But safety tools are like seatbelts. You put them in place when you begin your trip together, and if everything goes according to plan, you never need to think about them again. And then if something does start to go wrong in the game...
Like what? What the fuck are you gonna do to your players?
If somebody does cross into territory that was already discussed as being off-limits or meant to be handled with care during your session zero, then just like a seatbelt, the safety tools come into play, and they make sure that you...
Okay, I don't want any white people. I don't want to see any white people in this campaign. Okay, so what do you do with your NPCs then? You got players at your table that don't want to see white people in the game. What race would you put in there to substitute? Where are the white women at? You know. I don't want any cis gender people in my D&D campaign. Then what do you do? What kind of quests are you going to do? Are you the bad guys? Are the players the bad guys then?
You and your players can get through the incident unscathed. Everybody wins if you use safety tools.
Okay, are you going to tell us about the safety tools yet? I guess he is. Content warnings. Consent form. Ooh. What else? That's a long one. No, we'll skip that one. Speaking out of character, what is that about? I've never heard of such a thing. Is that a thing in D&D?
Question is, what tools are right for you? I'll admit, as somebody who's been playing online exclusively for several years now, my experience with safety tools has been kind of limited to the things that can either be put in place before the campaign begins, or what can be done verbally during a session, because we don't really have the...
You're a freak. I've seen some of your videos. You're a freak. And, I wouldn't let you near anybody. I wouldn't let you near any kids that want to play D&D, to be honest.
The opportunity for physical handouts like X cards or traffic light cards. So this is not a comprehensive list of every safety tool out there. This is just my experience with the ones that I've used at my virtual tables in the past 2.5 years. I'm not an expert in the tools I haven't used, so if you have some that you...
You're not an expert, period. You are, what do they call it? You are, how much meds are you on right now?
I'd like to discuss that do not appear in this video, like for example, the traffic cards or the X cards. I would love to know how they worked for you, so let me know in the comments below. This is something that I've started using more and more.
Do I need to look at his comments section? Yellow lights, green lights. Is there red lights? Any fucking red lights? Let's see. Anyone I know? Any weirdos that I know from YouTube in here? I don't see any regulars, really. Anyway, they seem like one-off commenters on his channel. Just drive by. You know, they see safety tools, they just drive. Like me, we're just driving by.
As I pitch campaigns to my players, especially if I'm running a pre-published adventure and I know what content is potentially going to be a source of pressure. Now, these adventures can be adapted however we want to, so there are-
Why don't they ban those books on drive-thru if they're so toxic? What are you doing with them? Why are they in your hands if those books are problematic?
There are some things that I will just remove if I don't care for them. Like, for example, the ableist material in Curse of Strahd. But there are some things in Curse of Strahd that I would never cut because they're actually extremely important to how I run this adventure. I run Strahd like he is a gaslighting predator, because that's what he is. And that's the experience that I want to try to explore with my players if they're open to it. So I make sure...
None of your players watch the Saw movies? What movies do your players watch? Have they ever fallen down outside and got a cut or a bruise? Have they ever beat up a bully in school? What are you, like a helicopter GM? Watching out for the players? What the fuck are you doing with these people?
Sure they know before the game begins that's what they're going to be dealing with. I don't have to tell them exactly what's going to happen.
Let's say a human being has never had any... They've never been worried or scared or traumatized or harmed in any kind of way their whole entire life, and then they find this guy, they're going to be in his game, and this guy is going to be... What? A teacher of life? Values and events and crap for these players? What? He's going to instruct them on life survival? Being a survivor? Oh, I'm a D&D survivor.
Happen, I don't have to tip my hand in any way. But it's still really valuable to tell your players what you expect to appear in the campaign. I'll put the content warnings in the pitch packet, or the one sheet, whatever it is I give my players, in advance of the game.
You're gonna get weirdos showing up to your game. Why are you doing this? Oh, that's right, he's a weirdo.
But how do I know what's going to need a content warning versus just being an assumption of D&D? After all, we all assume there's going to be violence and murder in our D&D games, right? Where's the line, and how do we know where it is? Well, that's where this next safety...
You don't know in real life? Did you defund the police in your neighborhood? Is that what you did? Are you one of them moral relativists? Everyone's the same. Whatever feels good, do it. As long as no one is harmed, it's okay to do. As long as there's consenting children around, it's perfectly fine.
The tool becomes extremely useful. The next one I've started using is the TTRPG consent form. I use it in two main ways. The first is, just like I said, I will actually go through the form and look for things that are represented in the adventure that I find to be something that can't really be changed.
Okay, Hasbro sells these books, right? I'm guessing. Don't they have... What do they call those things? The committees that go through the books to see if they're non-hazardous material. What? And you got this... Help me understand.
...changed, or that I wouldn't really be as willing to change unless there was some serious pushback. For example, in Curse of Strahd, there is some discussion of mental health that I was not on board with, so I don't include that in my game. There are some references...
Mental health of what? What race? What species? To you, a normal person is mentally ill, and you're just fine, right? Right?
As to self-harm that I include, but I'm open to removing at the wishes of the players. And
do you chow down Prozac like it's Pez?
Just as I said, the behavior of the villain I'm very upfront about, and that's the story I'm interested in telling if we go with that adventure. And something like draining blood will absolutely appear in my Curse of Strahd game in some form. So I use the consent form as a bit of a guide for what things in the campaign should be brought up. But I'll also give the consent form to my players in advance. Now I am...
I don't know, make all the players in your game watch Near Dark. And then have them come back to you and see if they want to do a vampire game.
I have a couple of issues with the form, and at some point I might put together my own, but I'm not ready for that right now. My issues with this form is that I don't really know if it gives the players enough information to make an informed decision, specifically about the stuff that they're on the fence about. Basically, the consent...
Just do a fucking void comp test on everybody. God, these people have no imagination, no life experience at your table. They have no way to defend against hypothetical situations. They have no answer for what... You find a tortoise. You find a tortoise in the desert, laying on its back. The sun, burning it. It's going to be baked. What do you do? What's a tortoise?
The form lists a bunch of items that are potentially things that people might have an issue with. And it says, do you not want this to appear in the game? Are you okay with it? Maybe.
What about the guy wearing the girl's wig and wearing the dress and he's complaining about real hot chicks at the game table? They're not representing women. The guy is. The guy's actually making effort to represent women in the game as a player. Because we all know that men can do women better than women can. Look at the sports. Women can't play sports worth shit. That's why you have men dressed as women showing up on their teams so that the women can win the games. Using men dressed as women. Men are superior being women, you know. They can even menstruate now, apparently. Because crazy people like you say so.
Maybe appearing, or are you totally fine with it appearing? Green, yellow, red light. Now everyone knows what the green light means. We all are on the same page about that. Green light, it's fine to be in the game. Red light...
Green light means run over people. Run them down. As many as you can. Pregnant women, more points added to your character sheet.
Light, not going to be in the game at all. And when I hand this consent form off, I will usually have some...
Yellow lights mean drive faster. There's more people to plow through. Hurry, because it might turn red.
Red items marked. There is some content that will never appear at my gaming table, no matter whether a player requests it. Sexual...
Oh... Why would they request such weird stuff, I wonder? Who are you inviting to your fucking game?
Assault, for example, is always marked as red, not appearing in the game, when I give the form to my players. That way, they know right away where my limits are as well. But I still have kind of an issue with the yellow category. What does the yellow light mean in this context? This isn't...
Yellow means piss, as in pissing in a corner, in a fetal position, because you've lost it. What happened to your dad? Where's your dad? What did he do to you?
This isn't an issue with the traffic light cards. This is an issue specific to giving this form to people and not explaining what yellow represents. Does yellow mean I'm okay with it happening as long as it is only done by bad guys and we are going to then fight those people? Does yellow mean I'm okay with it being referenced but I don't want it to be depicted on screen, as it were, on camera? Does yellow mean I would be very reluctant to have it appear? And even more than that, I think new players...
I wonder what movie ratings he still uses. Back when I was a kid, some stuff was rated PG, which would be considered rated X now. Stuff that was rated G would be rated PG-13 now. Because people are pussies. They don't know what a movie is.
Players don't really understand the power of D&D sometimes. The problem with giving people a check.
The power of D&D. Oh yes, it's super powerful. Oh, D&D 6 is coming out? Take my fucking money.
Checklist in advance is that you don't really know if people are going to have the same feelings as they are when they actually get to the table. And that can manifest in two different ways. One is that somebody might say something is okay, and then they get to the table, and it starts happening, and they realize, nope, never mind, this actually does freak me out.
Maybe they're freaked out because of your crap-ass role-playing. they don't know what to do at the table. They've never been to a game with you, and maybe they're like, oh, this is weird. I thought we were going to play D&D. Where are the fucking Dungeons and Dragons? I was promised fucking Dungeons and Dragons. What the fuck are we doing in this quest? Exactly.
Playing D&D makes my imagination go wild. What we're dealing with is too heavy for me. I'd rather we stop. That's actually totally fine. Anybody can make that judgment at any point. And the next safety tool...
What, you're going to keep them at your table? Well, let's just change the safety tools then until you're comfortable with the game we're going to be in. Just put on all the brakes. Remember when kids were sore losers? Too bad. Too bad. You lost. Too bad. Try better. Now it's like, everyone's a fucking winner. This is what happens when everyone is a fucking winner. Everyone's fucking special. Everyone got a trophy. Everyone gets a gold star. Everyone gets to go to first grade, second grade, third grade without any kind of information or knowledge or teaching. No one can fucking read or do math. Just keep... Oh, heaven forbid if this guy had to stay in third grade for 2 more years. They're all gonna laugh at you. I saw this back in the 90s. There's a school over here back in the 90s. I saw the kids coming out of the classrooms when the school bell would ring. And I'm looking at these just degenerate kids. And I'm thinking, in 30 years, these people are going to be in infestation in every city. All these whack jobs who are kids during the 90s, they're going to be crap-ass humans. And this is where we're at now.
Will help people deal with that. But the other thing that D&D can do is be extremely cathartic. For example, you might not want there to be gaslighters in your D&D game. Unless I tell you, this whole adventure is about fighting and killing one. Does that change things? I think it might. I don't know for sure, but it might. And I don't think new players have enough context to realize...
Can you handle Hangman? Can you play Hangman? Can you at least try that game with your players? It involves hanging someone. Try that game. Can you play Scrabble? It involves random letters, which could harm dyslexic players in so many levels. Because they never bothered to learn how to spell. And now they have it. Now they have a disability. I have a learning disability. That's called, you're fucking retarded. You never learn to read. You're too lazy to read. People that don't read or can't read, they'll never admit they can't read. They never fucking admit they can't read. This is what they do. They find something. They look for somebody. And they say, can you tell me the price of this? I don't have my glasses. Can you tell me the price of this? The price is fucking right there on the thing. They're not going to say, I'm illiterate. I never bothered to learn to read because I'm a sorry-ass bum, etc., etc. I'm a bane on society. Can you tell me what this says? No, they're not going to tell you that. They're just going to say, hey, I don't have my glasses with me. Can you tell me what this... And when they show up at a register, especially one of those self-checkout things they have now in stores, they don't know how to operate the machine. They act like they've never fucking ever bought anything in their life. Because they probably haven't. They're thieves. Loitering in the store, trespassing. They're pushing random buttons, hoping they get some money. Instead of spending their own money, they're hoping they get other people's money. And still be able to walk out of the building with the items they didn't purchase. That's like the normal thing now in California.
That if they mark it as yellow, maybe that means I want this to be in the game only if I can kill it, for example. If I can deal with this in a profound way. That's why I use the TTRPG consent form as a jumping off point for subjects. I don't think it can do the job all on its own, at least not the version that I've seen.
How about man up? Are you a man? Do you see yourself as a man? Are you embarrassed to call yourself a man? Are you? See, again, where's your dad? What did your dad do to you? What was your mom? Was she just a waste of space? Has no idea how to raise a boy into a man. Has no clue. Treated you like you were a defective daughter. I bet you that's what happened, because that's what always happens.
The one that I use is in the description below. If you know of others that you find are better, please let me know about those as well.
And now, a word from our sponsor. Are you tired of your hum?
Or worse, he was raised by two mommies. That's worse.
Showing up on the first...
What was it? Oh, a commercial. We got a commercial here. Oh,
yeah. Page of Google might not be the best for everyone.
Get off. Get off.
The third safety tool I want to discuss is the one I hinted at just a moment ago. How do you interrupt the game? How do you break the flow and talk about something that's happening at the table? Maybe it's not something that was discussed during session zero, but you want to discuss it now. It's a very simple phrase, and specifically, Mike Shea has been talking about this a lot on the Sly Flourish channel recently. Pause for a moment. During session zero, you make sure that all players know that at any point they have the chance to say, pause for a moment. You can do this for lots of reasons. You can say, I'm not comfortable with what's happening, or you can say, hey, I feel like we're kind of frustrated, can we...
Is there a fucking YouTube stream where this has ever fucking happened? When a player says, pause for a moment, I'm uncomfortable. Has that fucking ever happened on any YouTube channel, on any stream? It's hard enough finding role players in the hobby. I sure as hell know. It's even harder to find useful idiots in these games, ruining the hobby.
Just take a moment and make sure we know what the plan is. There are lots of reasons to pause the game, and having that option available to everyone is really valuable. As somebody who plays remotely and digitally, being able to pause is vital. I can't really give my players an X card. I could ask them to do like an X motion with their arms, but what?
Why don't you just focus on role playing? Do that. Role play solves anything. Oh, that's right. Your players don't role play. So they're like catatonic, practically, it sounds like. Okay, enough of this.